Dear students, before going to the topic, please think about these questions. What are autotrophs? Name the living things which depend on other living things for food. How do organisms obtain their food? Who are autotrophs? Plants and photosynthetic bacteria are autotrophs. By using sunlight, plants combine the food material, inorganic substances like carbon dioxide and water to make the food in chloroplast. That process we are calling it as photosynthesis. Because of that magnificent process, we all are getting the food materials and as well as oxygen also. And what about the other animals? Other animals, they are not able to prepare their own food. So they depend on other animals or other plants for food. Today in this lesson, we are going to learn about heterotrophic nutrition and nutrition in human beings. From this lesson, learner is going to learn that identifies different types of heterotrophic nutrition, draws the diagram and flowchart of digestive system, explains the action of enzymes on food, makes model of digestive system with the help of locally available materials, gives suggestion on how to keep our alimentary canal healthy. So first we will see the types of heterotrophic nutrition in this video. I already told you plants are the autotrophs. They prepare their own food. Plants synthesize carbohydrates by utilizing the inorganic substances in the presence of sunlight. These carbohydrates are used up by the plants. What about other organisms? You are observing here, deer is eating the leaves of plant, butterfly is sucking the nectar of flower, and the caterpillar is eating the leaf, mushrooms growing on the dead and decaying matter. Those are all depending on others for food. The mode of nutrition in which organisms cannot synthesize food and depend on other organisms for food is known as heterotrophic nutrition. In this type of nutrition, there are several other nutritions are there. Those are saprophytic nutrition. In this type of nutrition, animals eats the food which are digested outside their body. Parasitic nutrition. Parasitic nutrition means this type of living things depends on host cells and absorbs the food from the host. They damages partially or completely the host cells. Holozoic nutrition means here the animals takes the food wholly or completely, and complex food materials they take, and after that inside their body the whole food is or complex food materials are simplified by the action of enzymes. That is holozoic nutrition. Then what about unicellular organisms in which there is no any organ system? How do they obtain food? In unicellular organisms, they are also perform like saprophytic nutrition, holozoic nutrition, or parasitic nutrition. Now I will show you the nutrition types in two unicellular organisms. The first one is amoeba. Observe this video, the nutrition, how it takes the food. See, this is amoeba, these are the pseudopodia. This pseudopodia is surrounds the food material. Yes, after that this food material is digested in food vacuole. The digested food is absorbed by amoeba and waste food material will thrown out of the amoeba. Yeah, see. So in amoeba, Pseudopodias are helpful in taking or engulfing the food material, and food vacuole digests the food. And now observe this video. These are the paramecia. They are taking food through cytostome. Observe clearly. This is the food material. Yes, how it is taking. Observe once again. The food molecule is absorbed by paramecium. Yeah, this is the food molecule. See here. And later in paramecia, that food molecule is digested in food vacuole. And undigested food sent out of the body through anal pore. Paramecia is also called as a slipper animal cure because of its structure. They usually takes algae present in water. The food material of paramecia. Okay. We have seen the nutrition types or nutrition, how they takes the food, amoeba and also paramecium. And I want to show you another one interesting parasite. We all know that all plants are autotrophs, but interestingly, some plants are not able to prepare their own food. What are they? Which type of plants cannot able to prepare their own food? That plant name is Cuscuta. But Cuscuta is a plant species from the family Convolvulaceae. It is commonly called as Bangarutiga in our native language. It is also called as Dodder. Actually, it is a twine. Observe this. How this twining the host plant? It is a parasitic plant. It does not contain chloroplast in it. So, obviously, it depends on other for food. Here, this Cuscuta is depending on other plant for taking food. So, observe this carefully. This is taking the food material. This Cuscuta plant is taking the food material from the host plant through a special organs called haustoria. Haustorias are the root-like structures formed by Cuscuta. Cuscuta penetrates these haustoria into host plant to absorb water and food materials. Okay. See the root-like structures. How these Cuscuta plants are twining around the host plant. These are the flowers produced by Cuscuta. White petals. That flowers later produces seeds. And the seeds then later germinates and forms the anger plants. That anger plants again depends on other plants and they takes the food from other host plants. Okay. Now I want to tell you or explain you about the digestion in human. The complete digestion process takes place in these four stages. That is ingestion, digestion, absorption, finally defecation. These are the stages present in complete digestion, digestive system of human. First one, ingestion. Ingestion means taking the food in. Observe this video. How our digestive system works and what are the parts present in our digestive system. Eating food or taking food is called ingestion. How food travels in our alimentary canal or gut, you are observing now. Through which parts a food material passes in our digestive system. See mouth, buccal cavity, pharynx. This is esophagus. Food is moving in esophagus. Peristaltic movement. Dendrites into stomach. Stomach to small intestines. Small intestines to large intestine. Here to rectum, finally anus. These are the parts of digestive system in human. These are the three salivary glands. We have three pairs of salivary glands and the liver and also pancreas. Those are the glands of digestive system. And now see the process in our mouth, digestion process in our mouth. In the buccal cavity, we have teeth, tongue. When we take the food in, that food mixed with the saliva released by three pairs of salivary glands, and that food is mashed up or crunched with our teeth. For that process, our tongue also helps. What is the action of saliva on food? These are the salivary glands, I told you already. Saliva converts starch in the food into sugars and also softens the food. That food is called bolus. What is the role of tongue? The strongest muscle in our body is tongue. Tongue helps in mastication. From here, food enters into esophagus. Then you observe clearly here, this is the epiglottis. It is closing the opening of trachea. Then food entering into esophagus. See the movement, this is the peristaltic movement. Peristaltic movement of food in esophagus. From esophagus to food entering into stomach. This is the gastric juice. Stomach is a sac-like structure. Whenever food enters into stomach, the walls of stomach releases the gastric juice. How it releases means gastric glands present in the walls of stomach. That gastric glands releases the gastric juice. Food completely churned here and food becomes very smooth or it becomes as a slurry mass, like substance. Later it moves to small intestine. You are observing the longest part of our digestive system, that is small intestine. You are observing the ducts here, two ducts. They are entering into small intestine first part, that is duodenum. This one. From liver and pancreas, those two ducts are connected. This is the liver, the largest gland in our body. Nearly it weighs up to 1.5 kg. Pancreas is a leaf-like structure. You are observing the pancreas now. This pancreas releases pancreatic juice. This pancreatic juice contains amylase, trypsin and lipase enzymes. These enzymes acts on carbohydrates, proteins and fats. Pancreatic juice and liver. Liver releases bile juice. This bile and pancreatic juices releases into C, the first part of the small intestine, the duodenum. Here those enzymes acts on food. Bile juice and pancreatic juices acts on food. In the small intestine and also completely food is digested here. Because of the action of small intestine and intestinal glands also present in small intestine, that intestinal glands releases peptidases and sucrase also. Because of the action of all other enzymes, food completely digested here. Later, the digested food has to be absorbed into bloodstream. How it happens, I will show you now. Absorption of food in the small intestine. See, completely digested food is this. The finger-like projections are called as villi, which are present in the walls of the small intestines. These are villus. Villus is richly supplied with blood vessels and lymph vessels. Digested food is absorbed by villi and they transport these digested food material into bloodstream. From here to these digested food material transported to various body parts. Bloodstream you are observing now. What about the undigested food? Undigested and unabsorbed food enters into large intestine. From this large intestine, this undigested food is finally sends this undigested food to rectum. Before that, large intestine absorbs the water and minerals from the undigested food and later it passes it to rectum. From here to rectum to finally it sends out of the body or expel out through anus. Okay children, you have observed the digestion process and digestive system in humans from mouth to anus, how food transport in our body any. Okay, now I want to show you the peristalsis or peristaltic movement, how the food transport in esophagus and small intestines. By the action of muscles present in the small intestine and esophagus, food moves like this. By the contraction of muscles in the small intestine and esophagus, food moves forward. The wave-like movement in the small intestine esophagus, wave-like movement of food in small intestines and esophagus is called peristalsis. Okay. Now again I want to show you the salivary glands. They are also very important in digestion of food. Three pairs of salivary glands present in our body. The gland which is located below our ear is called parotid gland. Below our jaw, submandibular gland. Below our tongue, sublingual gland. These three salivary glands releases saliva into our mouth or buccal cavity. Here salivary amylase, the enzyme salivary amylase digests the carbohydrates and changes it as maltose. Okay. Now I want to show you the action of different enzymes in digestive system. First one is ptyalin. Or salivary amylase, it is released by salivary glands. You have seen that those glands, saliva released into buccal cavity or oral cavity. Salivary glands releases saliva. This saliva acts on carbohydrates and changes carbohydrates into maltose. Second one is pepsin. This pepsin enzyme released by gastric glands. Gastric glands are located in stomach. Gastric gland releases gastric juice and they act on proteins, changes proteins into peptones. Bile juice. In bile juice, there are no enzymes. Very important one. Released by liver, the largest gland. And the juice released into duodenum. This bile juice acts on fats. This complex fats are simplified by the bile juice. The process is called emulsification. Emulsification means breaking down of large fats into small globules. Next, amylase. Pancreatic juice contains three enzymes, I told you. Amylase, trypsin, lipase, released by pancreas into duodenum. These pancreatic juice amylase acts on carbohydrates and changes it as maltose. Trypsin acts on proteins and changes it as peptones. Lipase acts on fats and changes them as fatty acids and glycerol. Peptidases and sucrase released by intestinal glands present in small intestines. That juice released by intestinal glands is called intestinal juice. The peptidases acts on peptides and changes them as amino acids. Sucrase act on sucrose and they change it as glucose. Ultimately, the complete digestion process happens in small intestine. The digested food are absorbed into bloodstream by the help of villi present in walls of small intestines. Final view, I want to show you the flow chart of digestion in human. Food, we are taking the food into mouth, that is ingestion. From here to food enters into buccal cavity. In buccal cavity, mastication process happens, cutting, churning, mixing. That complete process occurs in here, and the food is mixed with saliva and it becomes as a slurry material. That slippery lump is called as bolus. In this bolus, that food material, later it passes through pharynx. Pharynx is the common passage for food and wind. You have seen in the video, epiglottis is closing the wind passage while food is moving there. From here, pharynx to food enter into esophagus. From here, the esophagus is also called as food pipe. From here to food released into stomach. From stomach to it enters into duodenum. Into duodenum, liver juice and pancreatic juices both are released into duodenum. And here these two juices acts on food and digest them. And from here to food passes to small intestine. The complete digestion process occurs here. Later, undigested food released into large intestine. Large intestine sends the undigested food into rectum. Here's undigested food stores for some time. Later, it is expelled out of our body. And finally, I want to tell you some interesting health aspects of alimentary canal. Overeating excessive fat food causes indigestion. That leads to reverse peristalsis. It occurs at this time in stomach and in esophagus, leads to vomiting. Reverse peristalsis, you have seen, that is a movement of a wave-like movement of food in esophagus and in small intestine. Here, reverse peristalsis, from stomach and esophagus to food comes back. That is reverse peristalsis. That we are calling it as vomiting. Vomiting also occurs when we eat something very harmful or poisonous. Without knowing it is harmful, we are eating. At that time, it causes vomiting. So we have to be very careful while eating food materials. These are the good habits or healthy food habits. Healthy people avoid problems related to digestion. They follow these principles generally. They have simple simple, well balanced meals. They taking well balanced meals. Eating food in a leisurely manner, not in hurry. They eat very leisurely and masticate food thoroughly. Thoroughly masticating food, avoiding taking violent exercise soon after eating food. So we should not do a violent exercise after eating food. Drinking plenty of water and having regular bowel movements. We should drink more water, but not immediately after the meals, after an hour. After completion of eating food, we have to keep the gap between the taking of food and drinking plenty of water. That should be 1 hour. Okay. If we do not follow the simple rules, definitely our stomach gets upset. Our digestive tract will get some problems because of indigestion. Sometimes it leads to this type of problems also. I think you all know these are ulcers. This is the our intestines. You are observing ulcers. Generally, it is a serious a problem caused by indigestion. Those are duodenal ulcers. These conditions occur more often in people who may be described as hurried or worried. So, ulcers occur more often in busy people who get into the habit of hurrying, over meals, and rushing from one activity to another without sufficient rest. So, while taking meals, we have to eat it very leisurely, and we should not always hurry and worry. So, be relaxed and eat your meals very slowly, okay? And these ulcers sometimes caused by the bacteria also. That is Helicobacter pylori. Not all the ulcers caused by this hurry and worry because of hectic schedule. Sometimes these ulcers also caused by the bacteria, that is Helicobacter pylori. And I want to tell you that finally, eat fiber-rich food. That helps us a lot and cleans our alimentary canal perfectly, and it avoids constipation. So eat fiber-rich food. For proper functioning of all life process, we require adequate amount of food. For that, we have to take a balanced diet. Okay. I want to summarize this. We have seen in this lesson that the types of heterotrophic nutrition, nutrition in amoeba, paramecium, cascuta, and humans, the process of digestion in human, salivary glands, action of enzymes on food, healthy food habits, reverse food, reverse peristalsis, and later evaluation. Children, try to write these questions in your notebook and answer these questions and send these answers to your teachers. Draw the flowchart of digestion process in human. Where do emulsification process occur in gut? Gut means alimentary canal, digestive tract. Explain the peristalsis with the help of diagram. Describe the nutrition in amoeba with the help of diagram. Name the part useful for cascuta to absorb food from host. If your friend is suffering with gut problems, that is alimentary problems, which food habits do you suggest him? Please write answers for all these questions. Thanks for patience listening. This is Pavitra, SA Bioscience. Thank you very much for watching again. And I will meet you again with another topic. Until then, bye everyone.